say you're wrong, but it's...
Yeah, damn him. Stay out.
Hello, everybody. Welcome to Cinema Royale, where we keep it classy whenever we can. It's what we do. I'm your host, Mike Mixtape, and tonight it's going to be a lonesome night just between two guys. James Sullivan is here with me tonight.
Tonight's broadcast is brought to you by lesbian makeout scenes that really don't add anything to your independent film, so please stop doing that.
What did you watch?
I didn't watch it. Devin watched it.
What did she watch?
Pelt. It's some independent slasher.
Oh.
It goes by all the tropes. They're like, okay, three bimbos, one jerky jock guy, two halfway decent guys out in the woods. Who's gonna die? Oh, lesbian makeout scene. Why not? Cause we can.
That's always good entertainment. I mean, regardless.
No offense to anybody if that's your persuasion or whatnot, but it's just kind of like it when you throw in. And I've had this experience before. When you throw in scenes like that just for the sake of what have you, shock value or sexploitation, you're coming across as desperate.
Yeah, but at least we won't have any of that in our discussion about zombie movies. Yes, it's the start of the Spooktober fest here at Cinema Royale. So we started off with zombie movies, and I was gonna do this alone, but James was like, "Yeah, I'll help you out." It's like, thank you, bro, because zombie movies is an interesting topic, and because it's definitely a creature that's worth mentioning because it's so popular right now. It's unbelievable. You got TV shows based on that. You have these movies coming out every once in a while with zombies now, and just like, why zombies? What's the appeal of zombies? I mean, the zombies that we know today are created by George A. Romero, basically, because there's several types of zombies, but the ones that we know are come back from the dead and start eating brains and crap like that. So,
or
cannibalistic kind of things, like eating flesh.
Flesh mainly.
Mm-hmm.
The zombies that you had before that were mainly, voodoo came back, used voodoo rites to come back from the dead, and it was all rather plain. But you know, back in the 1930s, when they were just trying to get hardcore with horror, but everything had to be relatively family friendly because you know the whole family is going to see this. Everything was tame. I just watched a movie with Bob Hope recently called Ghost Breakers. They mentioned one character in there who's a zombie, but he's when you actually see him, he's supposedly a zombie, and they were like, okay, this lady brought her son back to life via voodoo rites and whatnot, and he just looks sort of normal, but the way he walks around is dead-eyed and whatnot. And judging by the overall tone of the film, it's kind of hard to decipher whether or not he was actually, if paranormal stuff actually exists in this film universe, or they were just fooling around there.
Exactly.
So that's what you have in terms of the classic zombies, and then Romero comes in, and I feel so sorry for him because there's two stories surrounding the release of Night of the Living Dead that that explain why it's in public domain. One being that the that someone over at the lawyer's office just forgot to renew the rights for it, and then it instantly went into public domain. Oopsie. And the other one is that according to law, you couldn't claim rights to a film unless your company name was in there next to the movie title at some point. So instantly that thing falls into public domain. But he doesn't, anybody can release it on DVD and he doesn't get squat. But it gave him the clout that he needed to continue this series and do more, not just zombie movies, but other movies, period. Mm-hmm. And his always really stuck out in those terms. It almost sounds like an art piece when you say, "Oh, this one's a Romero."
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So yeah, I'm reading about the copyright status of the Living Night of the Living Dead. And it says, according to Wikipedia, it says, Night of the Living Dead entered the public domain in the United States because the original theatrical distributor, the Walter Reed organization, neglected to place a copyright indication on the prints. In 1968, United States copyright law required a proper notice for a work to maintain a copyright. Image 10 displayed each such a notice on the title frames of the film beneath the original title, Night of the Flesh Eaters. The distributor removed the statement when it changed the title. Because of its public domain status, the film is sold on home video by many distributors. As of 2016, Amazon.com lists copies of Night of the Living Dead numbering 17 on VHS, 208 on DVD, 9 on Blu-ray, and 42 on Amazon Video.
There you go. Anyone can grab this, grab up a copy of this movie, stick it on their DVD box set, and say, "Hey, we got a bargain bin deal for you. Yeah, this collection has Night of the Living Dead."
It is also available to view and download free on internet sites such as Internet Archive, Hulu, and YouTube. As of September 23rd, 2016, it is the Internet Archive's most downloaded film with over 2.7 million downloads. It is also one of the first movies known to be distributed on the internet. So yes, it is very, very, very much public domain, and I do feel sad for George A. Romero because it was just his first film in the series, and he eventually made more zombie movies after that and connected it to the film in a way, and it's just, mm-hmm. just like, ah, man, he doesn't get squat.
Yeah, all of these different movies up to a point exist within the same universe, but they're just they all deal with different groups of characters, which is kind of fascinating.
Yeah, because I've heard about the other ones, like there's Dawn and Dawn of the Dead, and which had a remake by Zack Snyder, which I've seen that one, and oh boy, mm-hmm. Zack Snyder doing his zombie movie, his first directorial debut, and he does a zombie movie, a remake of a George A. Romero film. Yeah, okay, didn't like it.
I did, but that was just my my particular preference there. It goes into the campy action genre a little, and I think personally, there's when you have zombie movies, there's many different categories of zombies, but usually what makes them actually work are on two grounds, one being subtextual and the other being campy.
Oh yes.
If you have the subtext, you have the Romero films. First with Night of the Living Dead, there was supposed to be subtext in there about zombies representing the new generation overcoming the older generation, which didn't exactly come across like that. But if you look at it in that regards, whether or not you see that, the film is still relatively horrifying by today's standards.
Mm-hmm.
You look at the second film in this series, Dawn of the Dead, which has a group of people trapped inside a mall. At first, they think it's amazing because they get to do all this stuff now. They've got access to all this materialism that they didn't have before, and then they sort of get bored of it after a while. So that's saying something.
Mm-hmm.
You have Day of the Dead, which which is very clearly showing zombies as a different, as not just a being in and of themselves, but sort of a representation of a different kind of human. Because we have one character, Bub the zombie, who's a zombie who's being trained by a doctor to sort of remember things about his past life. So this is either representing another race of people altogether, or not, maybe just a different group of people. You don't even have to think of it as race. And then you have Land of the Dead, which, oh my gosh, politics, 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 politics. This is so amazing looking back on this film, and I actually kind of liked it too. Land of the Dead has Dennis Hopper being the president of the last remaining human city, has a gang of terrorists that he sends out to kill zombies. This group of terrorists defects against them, and they threaten to blow up two giant buildings in the center of the city. How blatant can you freaking be? It's kind of like the movie is saying, "Hello, hello, we created Bin Laden, we created Bin Laden, we created Bin Laden." So but where the film does work is the zombies all have their own society set up in this film too. They've got their own houses, they're raking their front lawns and all that. They're taking care of themselves. Don't know how this this works with the zombies of the previous film, so maybe it's not exactly the same universe, but you get the idea. It's all subtext. You can do that with other types of monsters, idea that being the wars in fiction between vampires and werewolves, popularized by the Underworld films and Twilight, but it always seems to work best with zombies because they can be humanized or not humanized. And the other side to that is the campy aspect of zombie films, where you're just trying to be, you're not even thinking of having subtext in there. You're just trying to be ludicrous, and that's where we have movies like Return of the Living Dead, where they're poking fun at Romero's work, or Shaun of the Dead, Dead and Breakfast. Yes, that one exists as well. Or one of the movies that we watched, I believe, qualifies. Let's see here, Wormwood, Road of the Dead.
Yeah, that is like there was no subtext in that whatsoever. But it's like it was campy. I had to watch it two times because we were watching it the first time together. We both kind of dozed off towards the end of the movie, so I had to rewatch it to figure out what was happening at the end. But my God, this Australian flick is just like, it's like Mad Max meets zombies. Like, it is like up there being campy.
They could theoretically have gone very, very serious with this film. Let's be honest, the first Mad Max movie, it was ridiculous, but it was also kind of serious. I always liked the Road Warrior a little bit better, but that's just me. With this movie, we start out with a hero who loses his wife and daughter. He's a mechanic. He goes around the outback trying to find his sister and rescue her from the zombie horde.
Well,
yeah.
Well, the thing is with his sister is that, yeah, because she had friends in the garage and they're just doing stuff and they turn into zombies and she's like a survivor of that. And these two army men take her, and these, the scientist, oh my God, this mad scientist character is...
Let's stop and remember for a moment. His sister is into some kinky shit there.
Oh yes. Oh, it's...
She's got a friend dressed up like a clown suspended on chains, and she's taking pictures of it. I was like...
Yeah. I don't want to know that. And her sister has spent the whole time in this like lab with the scientists and other zombies. And it's interesting because I don't know what they're doing with her in this same lab, but the scientist turns on music and he's like jamming to Casey and the Sunshine Band for a little bit, and it's so hilarious. It's like, little dance, make a little love, get down tonight.
Hey, that's how I would work. Well, maybe not in those particular conditions, but you don't see me doing that stuff.
It's but so he takes a vial of blood from one zombie and transfuse it like through the needle into this female, the sister, you know, into her bloodstream. And throughout the whole film, I don't know, maybe the zombie blood did this, but throughout the whole film, she can control zombies. She can, like, kind of physically like turn into one and control them with her mind or something, like telekinesis or telepathy or something. It was kind of
It's
interesting.
so it yeah. There's something we actually had not seen yet. I can't remember too many zombie movies I've seen where the whole thing is just I'm gonna control we had the power to control a horde of zombies.
Which it kind of no it kind of akens to the voodoo in a way, where they can, like, a voodoo can control a zombie in a way, kind
Akins?
of I've been
I think
drinking.
you mean it's. I think you mean it akin to.
Thank you. I've been drinking. I'm sorry, people. I'm gonna slur my words a bit today.
It's kind of akin to zombies, you know? I mean, they're dead. You gotta have. They must. You bring them back, and they gotta have muscular dystrophy all over the place.
I love you, man, but come on. But yeah, that was interesting. I think that's the first time I've ever seen that, actually. It was pretty cool how she controlled all the zombies. And so the other crazy aspect is that, I guess it comes from the title too, and I guess it's kind of explains about the zombies a little bit, if I remember correctly. I don't know if I will, but like, they can't, for some strange reason, they couldn't, like, light gasoline or something, and they realize that the zombies are breathing like this
Their
gasoline.
blood is flammable.
Yeah, their blood, the blood is flammable. And so, and even their breath, you know, it's very flammable too. So they end up powering their car with zombies. They just hooked the mask up to the zombie, having it go to the gas tank, and just like, yep, let's drive.
Yeah, see that under normal circumstances, I think I would be demanding an explanation for this particular type of zombie plague, but because they did that and it was so ridiculous and so creative at the same time,
Yeah, it is. It is.
I think I'll let it slide.
It was. It's a kind of movie that goes crazy with its lore, and it's a great, there's a lot of, like, shotgun blasts, gun blasts to the head. There's a lot of zombies who, like, bam, 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 bang. I'm trying to remember most of it. It's just there's, like, traveling and trying to
That's a
think.
high octane trip.
It is. It's you can kind of think of it, like I said, it's like Mad Max, maybe Mad Max Fury Road if possible, because they travel a lot in this thing and they go from one place to another, killing off zombies.
They should have had zombie. They should have had a zombie hanging off the back of a large vehicle with a flame-throwing guitar.
Oh my God. Oh yeah, Wormwood, the Road of the Dead is actually a pretty underrated independent in Australian zombie movie. It's just something you have to see for yourself. It's ridiculous, and it's worth a watch or two, because I had to watch it a couple of times, and it's so ridiculous. It's just like, it's like, because there's one point in the movie where these army dudes are handcuffing our heroes. It's just, like I said, the main mechanic whose wife and daughter die because of the zombies, and then, or become zombies eventually. And then he has a friend who is like a Aboriginal looking dude.
Aborigine. Mr. Mike's Hard Lemonade.
He swears a lot too. He's like, fucking this, fucking that, fucking this, fucking that. All he does is swear half the time. But they're handcuffed to the car, and the other way out of it, he's like, we gotta blow it up. He's like, oi, mate, no, let the one of the zombies bite me, and there's a boomerang underneath the car, and I can just slice, you know, the army dudes and all that stuff. And it's like, there's this just giant boomerang. It's metal. It's a metal boomerang, and it's so sharp, and he just throws it, and it cuts the arm off or something. I was just like, whoa, what the fuck, man?
Again, it's the Road Warrior.
It's just so ridiculous, and it's just... I mean, I think it's probably the first Australian one I've seen. Like, I don't think any other Australian films do that. There's mostly... The Australian films I know are mostly, like, werewolf-related. I think The Howling, maybe. I don't know, but... As I'm thinking of...
We don't know too much about Australian stuff, except for the movie Australia, Tasmania, and Crocodile Dundee.
Yeah, so, yeah, in recent years, that came out, like, in 2014, 2015, but then there's another one that came out quite recently. It was another kind of independent-produced kind of film. Went under the radar a little bit, but it's has to do with animals. And now, animals can be zombified as well, and this has an interesting story to it. James assumed he saw this film, but he did not. Because we were... Oh, it was just so hilarious. I was laughing my ass off when I found out. We were talking about two different movies. And what did you end up seeing?
Zombies was the one that I had seen. And the backstory behind this was that I actually... I had remembered seeing this on Netflix. And I'm going... Several months ago... We had some old neighbors of ours come by for a visit, and their kids, who I used to babysit, happy birthday, by the way, today's their birthday. They're going off to college and all that now. And so so one of them's hanging out with his college buddies and is like, have you ever seen this movie Zombievers? In my mind's eye, I'm connecting it with Zombies from the Asylum. I'm like, oh yeah, I remember that one. That was, and we both had this entire conversation about two different movies, which we think is the same one.
Oh man! So, there was one night when James and I were planning a screening, and we're trying to figure out what zombie movie to watch, and he's like, oh yeah, we can watch Dead or Alive, you know, I've seen it, but you haven't seen it, I'll see your reaction. And I'm thinking, okay, but then there's this other movie you have to see, it's called Zombievers, and it's like, oh, I've seen that already, sure, I've seen Zombievers, and I'm talking to him, and I'm trying to explain the plot to him, he's like, I have no clue what you're talking about. He says the title of the movie you've seen, and I was like, dude, that's not the movie I'm talking about. And I was laughing my ass off, because it's like, oh, I just realized I was the...
yeah. So, for just this occasion, we had to make it a double feature.
We made a double feature, and it was good. We made it pretty well, but I... we will get into Dead Alive, but I felt like we watched it in the wrong order, because we saw Dead Alive first, which is the Peter Jackson zombie film, which later in the U.S. it was called Brain Dead, I believe. So,
actually, Brain Dead is the original title.
No,
Dead Alive is.
No, it's not. I swear. Hold on. I swear. Here, type this in. Dead Alive. Hold on. I swear. Right here. Yep.
And I'm on it.
Oh, okay. You are right. I'm sorry. You're right. Yes, it was originally called Brain Dead, but in the U.S. it's called Dead Alive. Okay, I was wrong. But yeah, that was the Peter Jackson one from 1992. So, that we watched that one first, and that was a big hoorah, but Zombievers, however, was like a little appetizer, because it is crazy enough, but not as crazy as Peter Jackson's movie. But Zombievers is basically the case of having both zombie animals And the other zombie being contaminated by toxic ooze of some sort.
We haven't seen that before, Return of the Living Dead.
it's one of it's the other kind of zombies. There's several kinds of zombies out there, you know. The most popular ones, like we said, the Return of the Dead kind of zombies, you know, resurrected from the dead zombies. This is the one that get affected by toxic ooze, and they go crazy and become rabid, and they can become zombies. Zombievers is basically the story of these three college chicks going up to the cabin for the weekend, and they're having a good time. Eventually their boyfriends come about and hang out with them, but they find that the beavers have been crazy. They start attacking, and they realize that they're zombievers. They're zombie beavers, and they try to stay alive throughout the whole process. And wacky, hilarious kind of shenanigans ensued, because towards the end of it kind of turns a little bit, which is, I'm not gonna totally reveal that, because you have to see it to believe it, because if I start saying it, it's gonna be a spoiler.
I think I know what you're talking about. I'm not, just for the sake of, just for your sake, I'm not going to spoil it. But the issue with this film is, I'm watching it and I'm thinking, this is cabin fever with zombie beat, with the sickness removed, and zombie beavers in its place. I say that because they go by the whole cabin in the woods subtrope, and they make these young adults the most thoroughly dislikable people that they can. Even the three girls who are going up there. Only one of them is somewhat likable because you're sort of her whole deal is she's been cheated on by her boyfriend, and that's what she's going through now. So you can sort of you're sort of meant to sympathize her for her a little bit, but by the end of the film, you're not really a fan of anybody here. And it doesn't help when her cheating ass boyfriend shows up either. So I'm wondering, at some point the bodies are all going to start dropping, and I'm wondering who I'm supposed to be rooting for here. But the ridiculousness of it, of this whole situation, zombie beavers, it's very it at one point it felt like there was a Critters vibe going for it.
Yes, those devilishly devious beavers, I tell you, they chew the wires to the telephone line so they can't call anybody. They chew down trees to block the road so they can't drive anywhere.
Their cell phones don't work, of
Well,
course.
they're up in the woods, you know, with the cabin, so yeah, it's like no service.
And we have John Mayer as a trucker.
Yeah. So, yeah, his first acting debut in this film, he's playing like a friend who's like riding along with this guy who's they're delivering this just truck full of canisters of ooze. And that's what you see at the beginning of the film. You see him driving around and they're just bullshitting. It's like and the driver's like on his phone. It's like and John's like, hey man, you see that deer over there? And it's like, yeah, I see the deer. They hit the deer, and then the canister of ooze falls out of the truck and goes into the beaver dam. That's how the beavers become zombievers. And they're just like, let's just check the back. And John's like, nah, let's check the front here. And you see the deer all smooshed up, and it's like, It's practical effects too, mind you. These are not CGI beavers, CGI deers, or nothing. These are just real practical effects, puppets. I mean, there might be a little bit of CGI, but it's unnoticeable at least. But it's just like you see puppets of these beavers, like, it start attacking. It's kind of
Except
cool.
for when they kill the dog, I was like, okay, that's totally CGI enhanced.
Yeah.
Oh, well, I'm sorry, did I give that away?
No, it's become a trope now that the dogs freaking die in any kind of movie, especially in zombie movies.
Yeah, what happened? Why can't the dog live? It was a little dog too.
A little dog named Gosling, for crying out loud. No, not Gosling. And Zoe, the character. What the character is Zoe. And she just goes, she's like, oh, you asshole, you tossed my dog in.
Yeah, this is a likable boyfriend character, right? Let's distract the zombie beavers by chucking the dog in the water so we can get us so they can go after that and we can escape.
I mean, it's smart enough idea, but then it's just like, all
Would you do
right.
it? Would you do it?
I mean, would you rather be stranded in on this little raft in the lake, just sitting there waiting for the beavers to pop up and bite you, and just I'll be like, yeah, let's just create a diversion. Sure, throw something there to give them something to eat.
No. Here's what you do. This is desperate. You take all of your clothes off. The whole group, all the whole group, takes their clothes off. They try tie it all together, bundle it together into some sort of chunk, and then they throw that into the water. The beavers will go for it. They think it's got mass, but it's nothing. It's lifeless.
Well, these beavers are smart, mind you, because they cut down trees to block roads, and they cut the telephone wires for, like, these beavers have a motive of these kids killing people. Like, it's weird, and they start biting other things. Like, towards the end, you see the beavers end up biting the bear you see briefly at the beginning, and he becomes a zombie beaver bear, and it's like, and because one of the characters is like, really? Really? Yeah, that's happening.
Oh yeah.
It's a ridiculous movie. You kind of, if you want to see zombie beavers go attacking, and it's you gotta have characters that you love to hate, because a bunch of fucking assholes, what they are, college students this generation, I tell you.
Yeah, well, they don't do themselves much credit by portraying themselves that way.
That's how it was written. So, and I think it's when they promote it too, I think, if you want attachable names to it, it's from the producers that produced The Ringer. God, there's another horror film, but then there's a couple of comedy producers, like from Where the Millers and American Pie. So it has a little bit of comedy and a little bit of horror elements to it. So it's independent, but it's got some producers behind it that know how to make horror and comedy films that work together. So it's on Netflix. You definitely can check it out, because it's been on my watch list forever, and I finally got to watch it because of the subject matter. Cha-ching! Move on. But
Let's
okay.
flash back a little bit.
Let's go back to the first movie I ever saw with James, just to see my reactions to it. And it's on my list too, because I knew Peter Jackson did this, and I was like, I've seen a Peter Jackson early work before. I've seen Meet the Feebles, because it was released on my birthday, for crying out loud, back then. So I was just like, all right, fine, let's watch Dead Alive, by Peter Jackson. Sure, it's a zombie movie. Let's just watch it. I'm just watching it, and it's turns out very well so far. It's got slow build up to it, and then at the end just speechless. I'm just speechless about the ending, and I just And James is
they
like,
throw everything at you.
And at the end, they throw everything at you. And at the end, James is like, what's your reaction to it? And I'm just like, I couldn't say anything. I didn't know what to say afterwards because I was just like, what the fuck just happened in this movie? I'm like, what? So, things I question in this movie because the main character is like, I would have done so many different things if as in my situation, in the situation that he's in, and I was just like, but,
it's campy. It's meant to be campy. It's not supposed to be taken too seriously.
No, there's humor in it. It's very funny. It's very funny. It's got humor in it. It's campy. It is cheesy, but gory at the same time. Lots of blood. Oh my god. It's probably the movie with the most kind of blood you ever see in your life. Like,
300 liters of fake blood were used in the final scene alone.
Yes, in the final scene, that's where the most of it comes. Like the final third act alone, just that's the price of a mission right there. The build up, the first two acts, it builds you up. It builds you up to understand what's going on and what happens, and you get some good characters, and you get a great character. You get a great character in this movie where he goes, I kick ass for the Lord.
Oh, well, let's start first by telling these guys, what the movie's about.
Okay.
It's about a guy named Lionel who's presumably, he looks like he's in his 20s, living with his mother who's a horribly controlling person. He starts hanging out with this one gal who believes it's actually in the cards that they should be together. There's this tarot reading scene and all that. Her name's Paquita. She's French, Latino, Italian, something.
Yeah, some kind of like that. We couldn't pinpoint the actual nationality of her.
It's like they don't even pinpoint it in the film. They just refer to her as foreign.
Yeah, it's just...
But she's cute, and, they go out on a date together, and they're going to the zoo, and their mom, his horrible mother, is shadowing them at the zoo. And she gets bitten by a poorly animated stop-motion rat monkey.
Well, that's how the movie starts out, too, because you kind of flash back a little bit at the beginning. It shows you Skull Island, of all things. Yes, Peter Jackson referenced Skull Island before remade King Kong in 2005. So, and it starts out, with these two people on Skull Island getting this... Samaritan like fucking rat thing, and you don't see it until you go to the zoo with these two people, and it is stop motion. It's a stop motion rat, and I was like, stop motion, okay, they could have done a puppetry thing, he'd worked with puppets in the past, but I was like, all right, fine, just stop motion. And yeah, so he does, the rat bites the mother.
The mother steps on the rat's head and
just kills it.
Kills it. I'm amazed that the zoo didn't decide to push any charges after that for stealing an endangered species. But moving forward, his mom starts getting sick. Turns out, whoever gets bitten by this particular species of rat monkey, they turn into a zombie after a while. They die, and they cut, and the disease brings them back. But this guy Lionel, he's got such a strong connection with his mother that he keeps the zombie around the house, and he's trying to keep it from, he's constantly kind of trying to keep it from breaking out and biting other people. And that's, the problem is, of course, that's exactly what starts happening, is that you get, is he ends up getting this whole collection of zombies in his house, and hit at one point he has a funeral for his mom. He goes up and digs her out of the grave later, but there's a gang of thugs there. they start beating him up, and the mom shows up, reaches out of the grave, grabs one of them by the crotch and pulls them down, and rips out his insides, and they're horrified. A priest shows up after a couple of these guys have been turned into zombies by the mom, and it's one of the highlights of the film.
Probably the priest
knows kung fu.
Yeah.
And he starts beating the crap out of these zombies. It's amazing. He just floor sweeps one, and the legs come right out, come right off underneath him, and he kicks the head off. The head flies off the body and shoots up a mile high in the sky. It's hilarious. It's that kind of film. It's, they call it a splatter comedy for a reason. It's very over the top.
Mm-hmm.
Very over the top humor.
Very over the top.
But you have to have a stomach for it.
Yes, yeah. If you're too queasy for like all the guts and blood and anything that results into anything like that, you're not in for this at all.
No. Yeah, it's a very definition of a bad movie, but
it does. It, like, the premise alone and everything they have, is, it seems like a bad movie, but it turns out to be a film.
It's a very well-made bad movie.
It's very well-made. Like, you see, like I said, there's stop motion in there for a little bit, and then I'm not going to spoil the end. I dare not to spoil the end, because, my God, if I start explaining that, too, that's also a spoiler, but I'm going to sound like a freaking idiot. The ending alone has, like, these kind of special effects, too, and it's just, like, wow, it turned out very well for a supposedly bad movie look, but it turns out to be really good. It's,
oh, yeah.
It is just, like, you're just, like, floored by what is going on, and it's, like, oh, my God, you're never going to see this again in a movie ever again. Nobody's going to remake this. Nobody's going to be able to top this. This is the movie, this is the ultimate zombie movie that you should go see. Because Peter, it's like no other zombie movie can top this. It is that fucking ridiculous.
I'm just gonna say, yeah, there is some clever puppetry in the finale, and in terms of practical effects work on a very low budget film, it's pretty amazing what they pull off here. I'm still watching it, just sort of thinking, how do they make this guy, how did they make this guy crawl around without any legs? Did they hire a fake shimp with no legs, and then they got his legs walking around, and it's like, I'm like, that they how did they do this? There's no CGI here. No. Otherwise you would be able to tell.
Exactly.
It's all practical. Guts come to life. A blender is used. My gosh, the final form of the mother. That's all I'm going to say.
Yeah. Yes. Oh, God, yes.
But yeah, what I think, is also quite amazing about this film, it's they made this to have an excuse to do everything they could with a zombie,
mm-hmm.
or anything that they creatively could. And my gosh, There is a good twist, a good serious twist in the film. The lead character Lionel is a guy who's the reason why he's so connected with his mother is because he was traumatized as a youth. They say early on, he's afraid of water because he watched his dad drown at the beach trying to rescue him. And it turns out that's, I'll just say this, the twist is it turns out that's not the case. And that's where we have a character progression, a bit of a character transition, which is surprisingly, it's surprisingly a serious moment
It
in the movie.
is like I was watching the movie and I see these kind of flashbacks to something and I'm thinking, is this gonna turn into something later on? And he's like, yep, and I'm thinking, okay, and then when it was revealed at the end, I was like, okay, that's a unique twist, and it is a great character development for the main character. Like you see him grow throughout this whole movie as he's taking care of all these zombies and killing them off at the end. It's just like, and mind you, he takes a freaking lawnmower, revs it up, and kills all the zombies in this massive bloodbath of a scene. It is.
Yeah, lawnmower foo, as Joe Bob Briggs would say.
I did mention to James I might have nightmares from it. I still haven't yet. I keep thinking about the last scene in the movie, but I'm thinking, oh my God, Peter Jackson, why can't you make movies like this anymore? Why are you not making movies like these anymore? Why the blockbusters? Just go back to your roots. Go back to your roots.
Yeah, this is the last movie that he made. There's sort of this trilogy of films in Peter Jackson's career: Bad Taste, Meet the Feebles, and Brain Dead slash Dead Alive, which they're all these are all the B movies that he made before he transitioned into being a more mainstream serious director. And it's kind of interesting to, watch this movie and think about it and then compare it to how did this guy go from this to Lord of the Rings? What clicked in his life? I don't know. It's an amazing film.
I believe this is not the last of it. There's also three other ones. After this, he did Heavenly Creatures, Forgotten Silver, and The Frighteners, and then he did Lord of the Rings.
Oh yeah, the I'm well, even Heavenly Creatures was it was quirky, but it was at the same time trying to tell a serious story about a series of about two young girls who actually killed someone in real life. It was.
Like we established it, it's the main the first three he actually did. It was like Bad Taste, Meet the Feebles, and Brain Dead. That trilogy alone of films is like that's mind blown. But the last three after that, just I actually still want to see The Frighteners, actually. That's the definitely one I want to see eventually.
Oh, that's a good one.
That is, I've heard of so many good things about it, and I was like, I gotta see that eventually. But yeah, after that, he just started working on Tolkien movies and the King Kong movie, and just like, really? Oh, The Lovely Bones, too, which I totally forgot about.
Yeah. I don't know, maybe he grew up as a filmmaker.
Yeah. But yeah, Dead Alive, just brain dead. It literally makes you brain dead. the original title actually works. It made my brain dead after watching it. I was like, what did I just watch? It's fantastic in so many ways, and it's just, it should be way up high when it comes to zombie movies. Like, I'm surprised it's been, I was looking at references, and a lot of people reference this movie. I was even, like, on IMDb, they just reference a lot of stuff, you know, connections. And I saw one, it was for Mystery Incorporated, the TV series. The cartoon series.
Of the Scooby-Doo series?
Yes. So there's a scene, I don't know what episode it is, but I was looking at the connection. It was referenced because one of the characters was actually ordering these Samaritan rat monkeys from Skull Island.
No way.
Yes. I swear to God. It's... hold on. Let me see if I can pull it up here. Because I was reading it. I was like... Why were they referenced that? Who wrote this episode? Who's... I'm sorry, I just... Because I was just like... It's so weird, because... Give me a second here, because this is just a connection I cannot believe. It's like... A cartoon referenced a... really graphic... movie.
A Scooby-Doo cartoon.
Let me go, if I could find it here.
Well, hey, if Littlest Pet Shop can reference Snakes on a Plane, why not?
Exactly. Where are the... Here. Scooby-Doo Mystery Incorporated, the episode The Secret Serum. Angie Dinkley's message on the phone... When I order a crate of Samaritan rat monkeys from Skull Island, I expect them overnight delivery.
Why would you do that?
I just
saw the movie.
I just like, okay, so in that movie, there's a crate full of them. It's like, oh my God, no, no, we're gonna have so many zombies now. And then I swear, this movie. It didn't break me, but it just, like, my mind was just blown. Like, I was speechless. Like, I never been speechless since James and I watched Killer Tongue. I was just like, what did I watch? And I'm grateful I've ended up seeing it, because it's just like, it's so watchable. People, if you haven't, please go check it out. It's worth a watch once, at least once. If you don't like it afterwards, fine.
Mm-hmm. All right, how do we bound off of that? What do we talk about next?
That's the thing. It's like Brain Dead, Dead Alive, just... It's the ultimate zombie movie. I mean, there's other zombie movies out there. I mean, there's some comedic ones out there that, you know... I've heard about Warm Bodies turning into a romantic comedy with a fucking zombie. That's so stupid. But then there's, like, Zombie Land, where you have this group of characters trying to travel through this zombie apocalypse, you know, and you got big names like Jesse Eisenberg, Woody Harrelson, Emma Stone in it, and that turned out to be a great movie. You know, it's just, it doesn't feature zombies a lot, but it had a quirky thing with it by having Zombie Kill of the Week kind of thing, where they showed a unique way of killing zombies. I think one of them was like killing them with a piano, chopping a piano on a zombie. But then they
end.
So.
And Zombieland was a fun film, I remember, but I just remember watching it, like, thinking to myself, okay, so I've seen movies where they did a lot more on less of a budget. How this thing got such a big budget for it, I think.
I believe so, yeah.
Not that that's a bad thing, but I'm like, I remember, I could be wrong, it's somewhere around, $100 million at least? No, it Oh no, wait, the estimated budget is around 23,600,000. Okay, that's a little bit more. Still, Peter Jackson, fraction of the budget, did a little bit more. But these guys probably they're traveling all around the place, so it's a little bit more Mad Max again.
There's traveling. There's you see zombies here and there because as they travel, they're trying to find safe haven, and they kill them off every which way that possible. And this one's caused by disease, of course. A mutated strand of mad cow disease mutated into mad person disease that became mad zombie disease.
Why not?
Why not? All I remember from the movie is like I do remember zombies and they just did their thing to kill them off, but I just remember it was all about the journey of it too, and then trying to move from one place to another. Woody Harrelson's character, and mind you, all the characters named after locations of which they were,
Where they come from.
where they come from. Yes, I was just trying to read that. So you got Jesse Eisenberg playing as Columbus. You got Woody Harrelson playing Tallahassee.
Emma Stone is
Emma,
Wichita.
her little sister turns out to be Little Rock, which is Abigail Breslin. But Woody Harrelson has a thing for Twinkies, and he's like, "I'm trying to find Twinkies. I gotta have Twinkies." It's this funny little quirk, and then they end up going to Bill Murray's house. He dresses up as a zombie just to blend in with the zombies so he doesn't get killed off. And Columbus, played by Jesse Eisenberg, just ends up shooting him just like because he thought he was a zombie. But before all of that happens, there's like a little scene where they just like pretend they're Ghostbusters. That's just so cool. And then of course we got this famous scene where Bill Murray's like, what's the thing you regret the most, Garfield?"
Plop.
Plop right there. But but the thing got so successful, ended up, this is an interesting story, because I end up trying to have a TV series out of it, and Amazon had the rights to it. They're trying to do it on Amazon Video, and it turned out that there was a failed, it just didn't turn out well. There was a failed TV pilot, and they're actually moving towards doing a sequel now. So.
Yeah, another thing about what this this whole deal about what makes this film work, like Dead Alive, we do have character arcs here that where the film is, it's funny and it's ridiculous, but there are serious sides to it. I'm not going to say that this is the best, but it's
No.
definitely, this is the, there's a reason why this movie, even for something in recent years, is held in high regard. Columbus, I want to explain a little bit more about the hometown naming thing. I think their purpose for doing that was they didn't want to, because they didn't want to grow too connected to each other as a group, so they didn't give out their first names. It's kind of interesting, but at the same time, it's like why by the end of the movie they don't know every single one's name is kind of amazing, because they grow to be this little road warrior family.
It's interesting enough, and this is, I'm going to surprise you, James, with this, because I just thought of this. Abigail Breslin, who played Little Rock, little sister of Wichita in this film, ended up playing a zombie in another film that came out last year. She there was a film that came out last year called Maggie, and she was in it. She turns out she has a disease, and she turns into a zombie. And her father, of all people, is Arnold Schwarzenegger.
I have not seen this movie yet, but it's on my Amazon Prime watch list.
It's. I was trying to watch any kind of movie from last year for a retrospective of films from last year, which we did in January, and I didn't mention it in the podcast, I don't think, but Maggie is an interesting take on the zombie genre, because you don't... It's all about Arnold, you know, being dramatic, mind you. He is so dramatic. You don't see him dramatic as this before. This is his, like, first dramatic role ever. And he's all serious. He wants his daughter to be better. They're trying to find cures for the zombie cure. And it's all serious. Like, there's no zombie killings. It's all focused on Maggie as she's growing with the disease and trying to turn into a zombie. And the father is trying to do whatever he can to cure it. And I'm not even going to dare to spoil. I'm not spoiling anything for the ends, because I'm not doing it anymore. I used to do that, but I'm not spoiling the end of it, because it turns out to be really sad and tragic. Like, it's not like the campy or the sub. I don't think there's any subtext in it. I think it's just it's an independent film, so it's interesting if you want to see Arnold Schwarzenegger being dramatic and a different take on the zombie genre, being all serious and trying to find a cure for it, like a instead of just branch.
Yeah. And we also, I believe, gonna briefly mention Pet Sematary.
Yeah, it's like I said before. There's a little subgenre of like zombie animals, and this is the take of which Stephen King wrote the novel for, basically having. Pets being buried in a, if I remember correctly, in a Indian burial ground, unless I'm thinking of a different movie, where it turns out that if you bury something in there, they come back alive.
Ah, yes, Indian burial ground. Like The Shining.
Or Poltergeist.
Yeah. Other Stephen King stories have done this.
Mm-hmm. So yeah, and it's just interesting how they just, I mean, this is a take where I guess it's weird because it's a point of which you're burying something into the ground of an Indian burial ground, which is haunted? That I never understood about the ancient Indian burial ground, how that would work. And bringing them back to life. I think that's not... I mean, I guess it's part of the trope of the zombies coming back to life thing. So, or people coming back to life as zombies. So, and it's mm-hmm. just crazy animals. I have not seen Pet Sematary, and I really want to watch that and Pet Sematary 2, which I heard was really bad as well. But I'm a sucker for... I was watching the trailer for Pet Sematary 2, and I was like... Okay, you got Edward Furlong in it. Why not?
Yeah. I have seen Pet Sematary. It's a... It's not just about resuscitating dead animals. There's a saying that... Yeah, there's a quote in the film that sort of becomes... a saying after a while, sometimes dead is better. The reason why they say that is because it becomes a very important plot point when a father's young son gets killed in an accident. Mm-hmm. That's not too much of a twist, because that's only halfway through the film, but yeah, it sort of deals with the concept of of letting go, or grieving, or wanting to let go of things. And let's just say when the kid comes back, he's not all there.
Yeah, but it's Stephen King, and you know there's something's gonna bound to be something. Something that's also on my watch list, but I wanted to mention it, was which is unique for a zombie genre film, was the video Dead. And this is the crazy one. Besides, not as crazy as Dead Alive, but it's up there with it. This is oddly enough a direct-to-video horror comedy film from '87, which didn't go into theaters, so it's one of the first of its kind, I guess. Basically, the video Dead is a writer gets a little package in the mail, and he's like, I didn't order anything. I barely order a thing. I order a pizza. That's it. And the people are like, I assist you. This is for you. We deliver it for you. And it's in this crate box, you know? You think the leprechaun would be in it or something, you know? And then he opens it up. It's like, it's a TV. A TV? I never watch TV. I'm a writer. I'm trying to write my book here. So he turns it on, and all he ever gets is a never-ending, seamless, plotless, black-and-white zombie film called Zombie Blood Nightmare. And despite, he unplugs the TV, but the TV comes back on, and it turns out the zombies can come through the real world, through the TV. And they're coming out of the TV, and they start killing and biting. And, of course, the people who delivered it misunderstood and delivered to the wrong place. So eventually time has passed, somebody else bought the house now. Oh boy, the TV's still there. These people, well, first off, the zombies that came out of the TV before it end up in the woods in the neighborhood, there's a dog in this movie. He goes in the woods and the dog gets killed.
Oh, why not? We haven't had enough dead dogs.
Yes, so it's not only... It's a trope in zombie movies now. We kill the dog. In horror movies in general, kill the dog.
Your mother ate my dog!
I totally forgot about that fucking scene in that movie. I didn't mention that, but Dead Alive has a dead dog scene. Which is the craziest one I've ever seen yet. Oh my god. So eventually... they end up finding the TV, which somehow went into the attic of the house for some strange reason. And these zombies keep coming out of the TV, and they start attacking and go in the neighborhoods. And the only way to stop this, you're never gonna guess how they stop this. How do they
the TV?
How do you stop the TV that never shuts off and streams endless the movie nonstop and zombies come out of the TV? No, you end up taping a mirror to it.
Huh?
Exactly.
Wait, the front of the tube,
so,
there?
So you have a mirror just draping over the top of it, tape it. And where am I at here? Because there's a couple, and this one guy wants to pick it up because he bought it on the yard sale, and the guy comes in and explains it all. He's like, you know, the zombies, they realize they're in a limited state between life and death, and the zombies kill humans out of that, but they are repulsed by mirrors because it reminds them of their own hideousness. Ugliness, whatever you want to say it, and attack when they sense fear, and the zombies can be destroyed by severely wounding them, thus convincing them that they are dead.
So so they're kind of like giving up at that point and just be like, oh, okay, well, I'm dead.
And then zombies must then be dismembered and left unburied to be consumed by Mother Nature. It's just like, I guess they're self-conscious about who they are and they don't even know. It's a weird thing, but it's...
I guess it's meant to be more on the campy side.
It is very campy. I mean, zombies coming out on the TV, that is very campy, and there's some quirky moments in there, and it's something, it's from the 80s, and you can actually watch it now, because since then, it's been released by Shelf Factory, and it's in glorious HD widescreen. It's been paired with TerrorVision as well, so it's something you have to go see, especially if you want to... I don't even know what The Ring did. I think The Ring was, like, inspired by it or something. I could be wrong, but I just felt like it was like, wait, why did The Ring happen? Like, the video did something. I don't know, but I was just like, zombies come through the TV. I want to see that shit. And I was just reading the basic plot from Wikipedia, so I was just like, it could be a watch. It's something different. With some tropes, with killing the fucking dog.
Mm-hmm.
There's endless amount of zombie movies, and I tried to watch as many as I could. Like, there's Danny Boyle's 28 Days Later and 28 Weeks Later, that those two films, which is a weird transition from that to Trainspotting. It's like, okay, you went to zombies after that. Okay. Interesting enough. There's if you look at the history of zombie movies, like through the list of zombie movies, you see the early years, like, you know, they didn't know much about zombies. It's like, it's all voodoo related. And then, you know, George A. Romero's movie comes out, it's all about, you know, coming from back from the dead. And that's the definition of zombies. And that's kind of true throughout the rest of the years. The 70s roll around, you get Dawn of the Dead that was released in the 70s, and the 70s didn't have that much when it comes to zombie movies, but the 80s come around, it's all campy and cheesy, you get all these crazy kooky ones. The 90s, there wasn't a lot of 90s, I mean, Brain Dead / Dead Alive by Peter Jackson is like probably the early one, and then 2000s roll around, the rebirth of it. Because I believe in the early 2000s you had, like I said, Danny Boyle's 28 Days Later and 28 Weeks Later. Those are the ones that inspired it. And then eventually it turned out with AMC's The Walking Dead. The Walking Dead became a huge fucking thing, and now zombies are back again, and they turn out movies nowadays. Just keep pushing them out. Get other shows like iZombie, and oddly enough, Sci-Fi's Z Nation, which is produced by The Asylum, which is on their third season right now. So,
I believe you're forgetting one thing about the 70s, the Italian Living Dead unofficial sequels.
That I completely, utterly ignored, because I totally forgot about those. Yes, the 70s had those Italian zombie movies. Yes, those were a big thing in the 70s. Yes, I totally forgot about those. And that's kind of what it... Because that's all because of Night of the Living Dead and people back in it. It's... we Italianos, we gotta make our zombie movies. And we call them zombie with the I, without the E. I mean... And then we just have this confusing franchise alone, because if we call it... But yeah, it's just interesting to see how these creatures come about, and I mean, I can dig them. I can, if they are creepy enough, I can tell you that, but they're easy to kill. Just shoot them in the head. Bang. But there's other ways to kill them, too.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's... it's a thing, and it doesn't seem to be something that's leaving anytime soon. So there you go.
Yeah, zombies are here to stay, and What kind of zombie movies do you like? Leave a comment below. Make sure you subscribe for more videos. I will definitely have some more coming out here, especially Cinema Royale stuff. And yeah, thank you for watching the Cinema Royale episode about zombies. Next time, we're gonna dive into a prolific director of horror, also known as John Carpenter. And we will have a guest. We'll have David Rose come on. The David Rose. He wants to. I asked him, and he was like, "Sure, why not?" And I talked to him, and he's like, "All right, he's ready." He chose Halloween. He's got dibs on Halloween. But yeah, it should be interesting to see who comes, who talks about what, and yeah, let's Spooktober begin with Cinema Royale here. Kind of miss doing these topics, especially in October, because I just love talked about werewolves and zombies years ago. Like, werewolves and vampires. Wow, I'm so buzzed right now, I can't think straight. Woo! This is what you get for drinking four bottles of Mike's Hard Lemonade. Until next time, thanks for watching. Good night, long live cinema, and I'll see you next time.
Brains. Yeah, bad 3D.
Reach out, touch space.